G'day everyone, it's Dan from Van Diemen's Land Model Bench, and this is my third update on the T-34 kit from Academy, 1/35th scale that I'm building. Since I last spoke to you, I've started on the painting process, and so I've had a chance to use these Life Colour Easy 3 system, and that went pretty well. This is my first go at doing the modulation sort of effect, and overall I was pretty happy with it. Did have a few dramas during the paint though, or the paint process. That really wasn't the paint's problem, it was actually my airbrush. This is my Iwata HP M1, which I've done a review on my site about, and I've been using this pretty extensively ever since I purchased it, and for some reason I'm having problems at the moment with the trigger action. You can see there it's stuck. So I've got to have some paint down in there somewhere, but I'm wondering if I can see where it is. But anyway, the upshot of this was I thought I'd fixed it, and I used it on this particular project, and obviously I hadn't. And as a consequence, I was sort of trying to get my head around how to use the paint at the same time as I was trying to get my airbrush to work. So there were a couple of spots on the model where I put too much paint on, and it sort of came out in a blob on this. And I thought, nah, that's just not going to work. It's going to have to wait till it dries. I'm going to have to sand it back and do it again later. But actually what I found was that the Life Colour paints actually, even in a pretty extreme scenario, they actually self-leveled so well that in fact you couldn't even see where I'd made the mistake with the airbrush. They basically leveled themselves out and you couldn't see I'd put too much on there. So to finish doing the model itself, I fell back on another airbrush. This is actually the first airbrush I bought when I got back into the hobby. This is a Patch Talon. It's a dual action airbrush with about a 0.35 or a 0.38 needle, I can't remember exactly. And this is a very interesting airbrush. If I, you know, for contrast, if I put that with the HP, yes, I know that's a single action airbrush. But if I compare it with, say, this one, which is my Tamiya HG airbrush, this is dual action, and this is actually a 0.2 needle. These two airbrushes, in fact, all these three, these two have a feel that's similar. You can tell the same companies involved in both. This one has a totally different feeling to this one. I'm not saying it's an inferior airbrush because I've done some good work with it, but it is a totally different feel. And this feels more like it's, how can I put it? It's more like a Cadillac. It's more comfortable in the sense it'll get you there, but you don't do any too many tricks with it. This is more like a Porsche. It's sort of finer engineering. But both will get you to your destination, they just do it in different ways. This airbrush is certainly more rugged. This would be the one I would use if you're a bit like me and you seem to some reason damage your airbrushes when you pull them apart. This one is far more delicate and takes a lot more time to clean and that sort of thing. But anyway, I got this one going. It's due for another clean, that's why it looks a bit grubby, because I'm actually about to pull it down and give it another clean. But this one did the job, and it saved the day, and I think the finish came out okay on the model. After I got the colour modulation on, and I was happy with that, I then had to seal the model, because it is these paints, these Life Colour paints, come out very, very flat, which if that's what you're after is great, but I wanted to put some weathering and some enamel washes and things on later. So I followed up with a coat of this, which is Alclad 2 Lacquer. This is their Clear Coat Semi Matte, which is ALC 312. It's not the flattest colour they've got. I suppose it's probably about third up the tree in their range. They've got quite an extensive range of lacquers with different levels of gloss. I really quite like the Alclad lacquers, I have to say. They work really well for me, at least. And I love the idea that I can vary the finish on the models, the actual the gloss level on the models as well. I think that adds another dimension. So I tried this one out because I thought this would do okay on the body, and it did. So that was fine. I let that dry for 24 hours. And then it was time to look at doing the actual painting on the model. And this is one spot where I wasn't terribly happy with the instructions from Academy. They give you only one A4 size sheet with the four different colour schemes that you can do the model in out of the box. And the for the sort of the basic sort of monotone type colour ones, you know, the solid colour ones, that's fine. But the first option is actually quite, is a tricolour. So you've got the brown, the green and the yellow. And you only get a very small overview of how that camouflage pattern should look on the tank. And yeah, I know I could have just done it freehand and what the heck, but I wanted to try and get it to look something like what was in the picture on the box top and in and what I could see on the instructions. So that required me to get online, and eventually the best source I could find was actually some pictures of a built Academy kit, the one I've got, done by Academy themselves and was used as part of their marketing material. So fortunately there was enough pictures there that I could get an idea what the colour scheme pattern was supposed to be, so I was able to work with that. But I thought that was a bit poor. I really thought that, you know, for the, at least for the tricolour, they could have given a separate sheet just to show you the pattern from the top and the sides and things like that. So it was a little disappointing they didn't. But we got there. Now, in the previous video, I said I was going to use a pencil to draw out the lines and then fill them in. And I started trying that and sort of came to a conclusion that was not going to work terribly well. So in the end, I did freehand the marking. So I'll show you what the tank looks like at the moment. You can see there's a top view of it, so you can see the camouflage pattern there and on the sides there as well. For painting the actual camouflage, I used my Tamiya 0.2 Superfine HGSF. That's a very nice little airbrush and that did a good job. For the paint, I used these two here, which are MIG or Ammo by MIG paints. This is the brown and the green. And, well, I'm not that fussed about these paints, I have to say. Even though I know the airbrush is very good, because I've used the airbrush a number of times, and I know it can do a very fine line, I really struggled to get these paints to work on this model. So I tried thinning them, and almost immediately I thinned them, I end up getting a spidering effect. I tried using a UMP thinner, and I tried using a lacquer thinner from Mr. Hobby. The lacquer thinner was marginally better, but both of them gave me trouble. In the end, I ended up just simply using these bottles straight. The paint's fairly thin, so I just put it in the airbrush, bumped up the air pressure a little bit to deal with that, and sprayed them straight. And I still had problems with the brown, getting a smooth, small line. I had a lot more success with the green. There was quite a bit of variability between these two just straight out of the bottle, which also sort of concerned me a little bit that that would be that much of a difference. I eventually got the pattern to the point where I'm happy with it. It's not perfect, and if you know what the camouflage pattern's supposed to look like, you'll know that, but it's passable. I think it gets the job done. But I have to say, I wasn't impressed with those paints. I think if I was doing the alternate type German camouflage where there are larger patches of these colours, I probably would be okay with it. But when you're trying to paint fine lines on a 1/35 scale model, these weren't winning me over, which is a shame because I've got quite a few of them. So hopefully it's a case of me spending a bit more time getting familiar with them, because a lot of these things I'm just trying out for the first or second time. What else did we do? Oh yeah, so the other thing to talk about with this particular kit, if you're looking to get it, is the decals. Now, I had been forewarned by a gentleman online on the Armorama forum that I'm actually posting a blog about this particular build on, that these decals were terrible. And, you know, you hear that quite a lot. I hear that a lot about Airfix decals and Tamiya ones. And generally speaking, they may not be one of my favourites, but I think, oh, you're perhaps being a little overdramatic with the, you know, how terrible they are. In this case, I think this gentleman was being pretty much spot on. These were awful. They're printed in register, so that's good news. And I had no problem getting them off the backing paper and all that kind of thing. But they are quite thick, so they don't adhere very well, particularly on the top here of the turret where you've got this cast finish. So you've got this rough textured finish that they're trying to stick to. The adhesion was really poor. That was a bit that surprised me the most. They really just didn't stick very well at all. To try and help the decals settle down, I used the micro sole solutions. That's the only ones I've got in my collection anyway. So there's the micro set, which I used initially to put the decals down. And then when it became apparent that they weren't going to settle themselves down, then I put micro sole on over the top of that. Over the course of about 2 or 3 hours, I put 6 applications at least of Microsol on to try and get these decals to first adhere to the model and then to try and settle onto the model a little bit. And it's okay. I wouldn't say it's great. If I was doing the kit again, I would probably seriously look for some aftermarket decals, or if you've got a big enough collection, maybe you've got some in the spares box, because they're really, to me at least, these are the single thing at least down this kit is these decals. So Academy, if anyone from Academy's watching, can you please find an alternate supplier for these, or, you know, talk to your supplier you've got now and see if they can improve the process, because while they're printed and registered and they look nice, they really were hard to work with. I'm a bit concerned because I've got an F-15 kit from Academy which looks fantastic. I just bought it recently. And of course, an aircraft kit's got particularly a modern aircraft, it's got 1,000 decals to go on it. So I'm really, really hoping that the ones that come in that kit are a better grade than what I've got on the tank here. But anyway, in the end I've got them all on. There is a small one that's supposed to go over the back there, which I haven't fitted. I'm just going to paint that black, so I haven't quite got to that bit yet. But that was a bit of fun. But anyway, I think they're passable. As soon as they had dried out for 24 hours, I then went straight out of the top with the Alclad clear just to make sure they were sealed in, and I hope that that'll also help them to adhere in the long term. And then it came to weathering the model. So I've been doing a lot of experimentation with weathering. It's probably worth noting that I wasn't looking to create a T-34 that was playing in the mud. I know that a lot of modelers love to do their tanks really dirty, but generally speaking, with most subjects I build, I'm not that fussed about that look. So I wanted this one to look more like it was being used in the spring or the summer, and I also wanted it to look like it was relatively clean and new, because you know, a lot of these tanks didn't last particularly long. So, and as you're getting towards, you know, the latter half of the war, so I didn't want it to look like it had been around for 3 years, because the chances were it probably wasn't. So I put these ones here, which is the oil paints that are designed specifically for modelers. So there's the aircraft effects set, and I've also got the mapping technique lights and shadows set. And I tried the dot pattern approach to oil paint, where you sort of put dots all over your model and then blend it in. Didn't go as well as I'd hoped, but I don't think that was anything to do with the technique. I think that was everything to do with me, because I was still trying to get my head around how that works. I'm okay with it. I mean, I think the final result is fine. You can, hopefully the camera is picking up, there is a bit of dirt and grime on it, but it's not over the top. This approach did do a nice job of dulling down the yellow, because the yellow looked a little bit too bright, particularly when I looked at photographs. Again, unfortunately, of restored tanks, but when I looked at photographs of restored German armour, the yellow looked a little bit too bright on the model to my eyes. So I think these did a good job of lowering the tone, and I did learn a bit about that approach, and I think next time I do it, I'll probably have a little bit more success. You can see perhaps on the sides here and on the back here was where I got a little bit more of an idea about what I was doing. Whereas I'd start on the top and things like that and didn't get that quite as good, but it looks good. I'm more than happy with it the way it is. What else did I do? I also applied some of this, which is MIG's enamel wash. I've got quite a few MIG enamel washes and really like them. This is one part of their range that I definitely like, as their washes. I've got quite a lot of their aircraft ones as well, and they're really good. This one's their brown wash for German dark yellow. It's MIG. Code is MIG 1000, and very nice. Works really well. It will work well for any tank, not just for the obviously German ones. And if you haven't used these before, give them a go. You need to shake the bottle periodically to make sure that the whatever it is, the pigment, isn't actually removed from the carrier. But that's about the worst of it. Or you just pour a little bit out at a time into a little tray or something like that. It's probably a good idea. And you just use them with something like this. This is MIG's brand. This is the odorless enamel thinner, which is indeed quite odorless. I did most of the detailing this model actually in my home, because it was really hot outside on the couple of days I had free to do the model, and I didn't feel like working outside in my garage where I normally work. So I did this inside and my wife didn't complain once. So I think this made it a lot easier. And this worked really well. Apparently it's a softer, thinner than the standard stuff you get from the art store. I don't know if that's true, but it seemed to work fine. And it did help with my confidence a little bit too, because as I said, even though it wasn't perfect, I could see where I was going with it. And I think next time I try that technique, I'll certainly be a bit better at it. A little bit more bits and pieces here and there to go. I want to put some streaking grime on, for example, which I haven't done yet, but we'll get there. The wheels came out pretty good. I ended up putting some silver edges around the wheels, and I did that using the Tamiya weathering powders, or weathering system, whatever you want to call that. So they're like little mascara type containers, and you just sort of rub it on. Originally, these wheels, which I'd done separately, were actually a different color. And so I sort of blended them in a bit, and I used just some of the darker shade of the Life Color paint. And interesting enough, the deep shade is the one I used. And interesting enough, I was able to spray that, because I only needed to put a little tiny amount on. I just sprayed that straight out of the bottle, and it worked great. So, you know, because that paint's fairly thin, so you can get away with using it that way if you want to. So that was good. Gave myself a little bit of time to think about the tracks and how I wanted them to look. And again, because I wanted this to be more of a summer spring finish on the tank, I wanted my tracks to be a starting point to look a little bit more clean. So what I've done here is I've painted these tracks with some tire black H77 from Mr. Hobby's Aquas range, and then I went over that with a bit of a wash, which was, from memory, well, I think I did a little bit with Dark Tracks, which is a MIG colour, which I'd thinned down quite a lot. And I ended up using also some of the brown wash as well. When that had dried, I then turned the tracks over and looked at trying to weather them a little bit. But again, not excessively. I just wanted them to look a little bit like they've had a bit of work. So I used primary colour for the sort of silver finish. I don't know if you can see that on the track there, but you can also see the bit of wear on the teeth there as well. Hopefully that's coming up, and a bit of silver there just being picked up by the camera. Do keep in mind too that the camera tends to exaggerate this kind of thing, so it's very hard to show you, because, you know, sometimes the camera doesn't do a great job. But hopefully there you can see there is some change in colours as well, which was something I was after. And I also put a little bit of silver there on the back, just to sort of show that the tracks are wearing. So I wanted to suggest maybe this tank was being used in hard surfaces, maybe on gravel or cobble roads, in fields, that kind of thing. So it wasn't actually going through the muds as per se. So the primary colour I used for that in the Tamiya Weathering Master System is the titanium. This is kind of my go-to colour, I have to say, for an awful lot of projects. It's a very nice shade of steel. This is a very old set. You can see it's looking a bit grubby, but it works absolutely fine. And this, I've had this for, well, as long as I've been back in the hobby, a couple of years. And I use these all the time. If you have not explored the Tamiya Weathering Master System, I really cannot recommend them enough to you. You need to get them and have a go, and at least get one set and try it out, because they really are good. And even though you don't seem like you get a lot, they'll last you a very long time. And if you put a tiny amount onto your brush and spread it around, and it'll go a long, long way. So I used the titanium to give me that sort of worn finish there on the teeth, and also a little bit of silver coming through where the track's starting to wear. And when that had gone on, I then sort of followed it up with a couple other colours, which I'm just trying to find for you. So here we go. So for example, I used a bit of oil stain just to vary the darker colours a bit, give it a bit more patches. And I also used, where are we, a little bit of kind of the, it wasn't mud actually, I'm trying to think what I used. I don't think I've got it there, hang on. A bit of soot, I used that as well, which is just another variation of black, obviously. And yeah, I think I just pretty much used colours like this mud and light sand, just to sort of vary it a little bit. Not too much, probably more than mud, actually. I'm going to be using a bit more of that later. But I'm not sure that that was the primary colour, though. I'm just trying to remember which one was. Yeah, it's not really coming to me, I have to say. But anyway, I know the titanium was the main metal colour, and then I just varied it a bit with some of the others. I don't have a real science to doing that. I just sort of eyeball it. I have a look at the model and think, well, you know, this works good or not. That there's a classic example where I'll put a bit of black soot on, because you can see a bit. I've had a fingerprint there from some metal, so that's where I'll use it for sure. I did all the track links as well, so all the track links have also been done the same way. They've been treated the same way, so they're now ready to go on. So the next phase, I'll be gluing the track together, which again will be the first time that I've done this kind of track on a model, so that'll be interesting. But anyway, they all went reasonably well, so I'm quite happy with that. And once all the track is on the model itself, then I'll look to add some dust, and that'll be a combination, I think, of the Tamiya weathering powders and probably some paint as well, maybe some pigment. I have got pigment for dust. I'm just looking at what I've got up on the shelf there. So yeah, it'll probably be a combo job. I did put some silver on there. Again, I don't know if that's, you can pick that up because they're steel wheels. So I did actually try and simulate that this tank, that the paint on the tank is starting to wear a little bit. You can see it there on the rollers as well. It's a bit of silver. And I also varied the colours a little bit because I wanted to sort of suggest that maybe this tank's had, you know, replacement wheels at some point. All the wheels were done separately and then fitted. That kind of thing. Don't know whether that would be the case, but I just sort of like the look of it. So I went with that. Same on that side, you can see. So overall, it went pretty well. Underneath is grubby, but, you know, I probably will reactivate that. That's a couple of spots there. It's not quite right. One of the good things about using these oil paints, by the way, these oil paints, is when you, even if I put a bit of thinners on that now, that'll reactivate, and I can sort of blend that in a little bit better. So it's a useful technique for that respect. So I'm going to keep going with the oil paint techniques because I think that they give you quite a few options. And the oil paints, I mean, I've got those two packs here, and honestly, there's enough paint in those to last me a lifetime. So, you know, it's worthwhile me getting a little bit more proficient and confident with that technique, because I will get a lot more value out of it for my armoured vehicles, and indeed, I imagine, for any other type of vehicle that I'm going to be doing. So that's where we're up to with the T-34 in the next video. Obviously, probably will be my last one, because by then I should have everything assembled and I can show you the final model. It's been, so far, quite a lot of fun. A few frustrations, but most of them are nothing to do with the kit, except perhaps the decals. Everything else has really just been up to me trying to get my head around the different techniques and how to make it work. But overall, for something I haven't built since, you know, I haven't built one of these sort of kits since the 80s, I'm pretty happy with that. So I'll catch you in part 4, where we'll talk about the last steps for the assembly and show you the finished model. Thanks for watching, and we'll catch you on the next video.